Okay, so thanks for coming. We're pleased to have the last two lectures of Ulf Meissner's lectures on effective field theory. So he'll be giving the first talk now at 3 o'clock. We'll take a little bit of a break and then do this next one approximately around 4 o'clock, maybe earlier, maybe later. Please welcome Ulf again.
Yeah, thanks, Ian. So here's the introduction, what I want to do today. So yesterday we did the basics of EFT, using also some model EFT to study certain aspects. Today I want to go into QCD, so in particular, this will be the first hour, essentially a bit more, derive the kinetic dynamics of QCD, and then in the second lecture, I want to show you how you can test this kinetic dynamics in particular hadron hadron scattering.
Fast runs to yesterday, in case we didn't steal it.
So QCD chiral dynamics. So the first thing I want to discuss is chiral symmetry. This might be well known, but I cannot hurt. So let's look at the Lagrangian of a massless free fermion field of this form. And then you can decompose this four spinor into a left and right handed component by this simple algebraic manipulation. This is a left handed projector, this is a right handed projector. So you have decomposed the field in the left and right handed component. And you can easily see that these are projectors because gamma 5 squared is 1. So you see that the square is the same as the operator. These things are orthogonal, and the sum is 1. And essentially, these new states, psi L, psi R, are helicity eigenstates. If you operate with the helicity operator, which is sigma of t, a spin operator times momentum divided by the magnitude of the momentum on these fields, you get plus minus 1/2, which are the helicity eigenstates, right-handed, and that's right-handed or left-handed. And now if you plug this in, this decomposition in this Lagrangian, you see that you essentially get two copies of the Lagrangian, one time just with left-handed field and one time just with right-handed field. There are two worlds. There's a world of the right-handed field and the world of the left-handed field, and they don't interact with each other. And of course you also see immediately that the mass term, which has this generic form for fermion psi by m psi, breaks this, because if you write this now in terms of these fields, you see that it's something like psi by right, m psi left, plus, if this is real, psi by left and psi right. So a mass term necessarily breaks this symmetry. Now QCD is the theory we want to look at. QCD is a series of strong interaction, which has this very compact form as a Lagrangian. So there is a gluon field strength sensor squared, which contains the propagator and also the self-interaction of the gluon, so this triple and quadruple gluon vertex. Then there's a quarkish part where you have the kinetic energy and the coupling by gauge principle is an SU3 color gauge theory through the Gell-Mann matrices to the gluon field. So these gauge fields are called gluons, and there are 8 of them because SU3 has 8 independent generators. And you see here in the field strength sensor that you have these typical forms, you know, from QED, and then there are the self-interactions lead to these terms. So here's the coupling of the quarks to the gluons, and then there's this mass term. And these fermions, the quarks come in 6 flavors, which are called up, down, strange, charm, bottom, and top. And this is, if you choose the field properties, that the diagonal mass matrix, which contains the so-called current quark masses, mu, md, ms, and so on. So this Lagrangian is based on local color gauge invariance. It has these nonlinear couplings. These nonlinear couplings lead to the strong running of this strong coupling constant. So this g here is called the strong coupling constant. And you form usually alpha s with g squared over 4 pi. And if you plot this as a function of momentum transfer or energy, you see that at energy scales of the mass of the Z boson, 90 GeV is of the order 0.1. It's a perturbation, perturbation theory. But in the region of interest to us, so the proton mass, 1 GeV, which is relevant for also for nuclear physics and most of hadronic physics, this is largely kind of the perturbation theory because the coupling constant is close to 1. Now, this theory splits into sectors that are so-called light quarks, up, down, and strange, where light means that the mass of these quarks is much less than the typical hadronic scale of a few hundred MeV, and the heavy quarks, the charm, the bottom, the top, have masses of 1.4, 4, and 170 GeV, which is much larger than the typical hadronic scale of a few hundred MeV. And I will mostly confine myself to the sector of the light quarks. Just in the end, I will add some heavy quark physics. And you also know that while this is a fundamental gauge theory of quarks and gluons, quarks and gluons themselves can never be seen in isolation as free fields. You only see them in terms of strongly interacting particle hadrons. So that is so-called confinement. So these fundamental degrees of freedom of QCD are confined within hadrons like protons, neutrons, pions, and so on, which of course makes the theory more difficult but also more interesting. And now we want to analyze the chiral symmetry of QCD. So three-flavor QCD, which means up, down, and strange quarks. So we rewrite the Lagrangian as a chirally symmetric part, and the mass term is split off explicitly. So this is a 3x3 matrix with the entries mu, mb, and ms are the light quark masses. This Q is a triplet of the up, down, and strange quarks. And you can easily see that this LQCD0 is invariant under chiral rotations, which means you perform SOC left but SOC right. So just generalization of what I showed you before for left and right handed fields, just with the eight components, because the gluons are completely colorblind, so they are not affected by such flavor transformation, and you can show easily that in terms of the prime fields and prime derivatives, you get the same Lagrangian. So Q prime is just this field which is again decomposed into right and left-handed components, and you can independently rotate the right-handed components by matrix R, which is an element of SU3 right, and you can independently rotate the left-handed quarks by an SU3 left matrix, which is called capital L here. And so QCD is invariant under this transformation, at least this part is also mass term. As we have seen before, the mass term explicitly breaks this. And you know, when there's a symmetry, you have conserved currents, just by Noether's theorem. And therefore, you have, since there are eight generators of this SU3 left cross SU3 right, you have eight left or right-handed conserved currents that take this form. Q bar gamma mu lambda A, these are the Gelman matrices, SU3 matrices, A runs from 1 to 8, Q left or right. And these are conserved, so d mu divergence of these currents is zero. And you can also sometimes, instead of left and right handed currents, one talks of vector and axial vector currents, where the vector current is simply the sum of left and right handed currents, and the axial vector is the difference. So that is equivalent language. So either you talk of left, right, or vector, axial vector. It's just a linear transformation. Sometimes this latter form is more convenient. Now, this is the symmetry of the underlying Lagrangian or the Hamiltonian of QCD. But now we can ask the question, is the symmetry reflected in the vacuum or the hadron structure? It does not necessarily have to be the case, as we will see in a moment. And so this, in fact, is the chiral symmetry is not visibly, so-called, but says spontaneously broken. And there are various arguments. Some of them I will discuss in more detail on the following transparencies. First of all, if there would be chiral symmetry, we would have parity doubles. So to any hadronic state, there should be a state of the same mass but with opposite parity. I show you how you would derive this in the next transparency. If there would be chiral symmetry, the correlator of two axial currents should be the same as the correlator of two vector currents. I also derive this in the next transparency. And this is, you can extract, in fact, from data of tau decays into in tau antineutrino and not an even number of pions. And you clearly see this is a rho peak, that this is not 1, it's not 0. This is just the difference of this VD minus AA. Clearly this is extracted from data, this is unequal 0. Then also the scalar condensate, Q bar Q, acquires a vacuum expectation value, which could not happen if you would have the full symmetry. Then there's a general theorem by Warf and Witten, which also gives some support of this symmetry breaking, which I don't discuss in detail. And then you always have almost massless pseudo-scalar bosons. And this means that this, and I derive all these statements in the following. The chiral symmetry is realized in this so-called Nambu-Goldstone mode. You have the interacting masses through the scalar excitation. So here's a typical energy mass plot of the lightest hadron. There's a pion, and then just look at SU2. Then the next particles are the rho and the omega meson, about 770 MeV. And you see there's a big mass gap between this state and the other, and it's the same in SU3. And these pions and in SU3 kaons and etas are considered the Goldstone bosons of this spontaneous symmetry breaking. And they are not exactly masses because, of course, the pion, the quark mass are not exactly zero, but they are small, so they get some perturbative mass. And this scenario with this big mass gap, this is just the scale separation I talked before. This, of course, calls for an effective field theory where you have active degrees of freedom with pions, and then all these heavy degrees of freedom are integrated out. And this effective field theory is called current perturbation theory. I developed this in the rest of the hour. So now let's make some of these statements more precise. So I said to you that there should be, if the symmetry is the current symmetry of the Lagrangian is also symmetry of the vacuum or the spectrum, you should have parity doublets, the so-called Wigner mode. So in that case, acting with a vector operator or an axial vector operator, so there's a vector operator QA, and of course eight of them, or an axial vector operator, there are also eight of them, they should annihilate the vacuum. Then the vacuum has the same symmetry as the Lagrangian. So because from a conserved current, you can construct a conserved charge just by integrating over all space. Now, since these are conserved, the time derivatives of the axial charges are zero. And therefore, that means that the Hamiltonian commutes with these operators. It's just standard quantum mechanics. And now here comes the argument. You can construct a single particle state of the Hamiltonian, which call it psi p, and has energy ep. Now you perform an axial rotation on this state. So here's my axial rotation acting on the state psi. And now I know that h and q commute, and therefore I can pull this whole e to the iq5 on the left side of the Hamiltonian. Just by Baker-Hausdorff formula, I do this step by step, and then I see, I know that this here is just by this the energy, but the energy is of course a number, so I can pull out the energy again from this phase. And now you see I have an eigenstate with the same energy because of this is an axial vector, the parity of this object will be opposite to the parity of this object. Because Q5 is an axial vector, then you can just look at the parity transformation to see that you get an extra sign. So this state here has the same mass but of opposite parity. So if you would have the full symmetry in the ground state, you would get this parity doubling. We don't observe them. There's a proton with parity plus, but there's not a proton with parity minus. There's a rho meson with a parity, but there's not a rho prime meson, same mass opposite parity. And here's the argument that in this limit, the VV and A spectral function should be the same. So VV is L plus R times L plus R, L squared plus R squared plus 2LR. Now, these are orthogonal, therefore, acting with this on the two vacuum states here, these are orthogonal states, so this cross product vanishes, so you have L squared plus R squared. Same for AA, you have L minus R squared, L squared plus R squared minus 2LR, again, this vanishes, so that should be the same. I showed you just from data that they're not the same. So these are arguments why one believes that the chiral symmetry is spontaneously broken. And now I told you that when you have this symmetry breaking, there should be massless particles for the broken generators. And these are the so-called Goldstone bosons. So that is, argument is also very easy to make, at least in a hand-waving way. So let's assume that there is no explicit symmetry, so no, the masses are all zero, so there are no masses. So now we consider so-called broken generators. So the Q still commutes with the Hamiltonian, but now this is not the eigenstate of the vacuum anymore. So Q acting on the vacuum is no longer zero. Of course, this is mathematically not correct. You have to do this in a finite volume. You have then to regularize this and go to the infinite volume limit, as described, for example, in this article by Bernstein. But this is mathematical things. You don't want to do it here. So this is a statement for a broken generator. So of course, the Hamiltonian commutes with Q, but Q is not the eigenstate of the vacuum anymore. Now you can, of course, define a particle state psi as Q0, because that's not the vacuum anymore. Just cause it as a particle state psi. This is up to you. And now you can calculate what is the energy for the state. So H psi, what is this? So H psi is HQ acting on zero, but Q commutes with H, so this is QH and zero. By definition, the energy of the ground state is zero. So the energy of the state is also zero, and therefore not only the ground state is zero, energy zero, but also all these states you can generate by acting with this broken charge on the vacuum. So you can have a one particle state, two particle state, so you can have infinitely many massless particles. So there exist massless excitations in the theory which are non-interacting as E and momentum go to zero. And they must be non-interacting because otherwise you could lower the energy of the vacuum by adding more and more of these. Or if when it would be attracted, if the interaction would be repulsive, this two particle state would not have zero energy anymore. So their interaction must vanish as energy p goes to zero because they must be completely degenerate with the ground state. So these are the Goldstone bosons, and of course you have one of these states for each broken generator. So in our case there are 8 broken generators, you should 8 of these states. And explicit symmetry breaking, there's some small perturbative parameter, which we call epsilon, so like the quark mass term, then you see that the Goldstone boson mass square is proportional to symmetry breaking. I work it out in more detail later. So in QCD you see that the pile mass square is proportional to the sum of the light quark masses. So this is considered to be a small perturbation so that you can do perturbation theory. And then you get, instead of zero masses, like here you get small but finite masses. And this you can do in QCD, and I work that out now in much detail. So I start with the Carré Lagrange, which of course was mostly worked out by Gasser, Leupel and Weinberg. So you map by the symmetries of QCD this on an effective theory which has pions and nucleons as the asymptotic fields. The pions are the Goldstone bosons of your symmetry breaking, and the nucleons are considered as some meta fields to which the pions can couple. So instead of working with quarks and gluons, you work with pions, nucleons, and also external sources like photons and whatever you want to probe your pions and nucleons with. So because of the spontaneous kind of symmetry breaking of QCD, these pions are Goldstone bosons. And therefore, you have a systematic expansion in powers of momenta of the Goldstone bosons over this current symmetry breaking scale, which is the order 1 GeV, the typical hadronic mass scale, and also mpi over, so the explicit breaking mpi of lambda chi. And you see, if momenta are small compared to 1 GeV and the pile mass is 140 MeV, so 1/7 of this, you have this, these are your small expansion parameters for the effective field theory. And the sectors where you just have pions or one nucleon, so these sectors are perturbative in this Q, this is called perturbation theory, and there are parameters which you have to fit, which are called low energy constants. Of course, there are unknown parameters which you have to fit, and the other stuff I don't discuss here. And now I want to show you how you construct this Lagrangian and how you can, what you can derive from it. So consider first the purely Masonic part, so what I call here L pi pi, and I just do it in general for SU3 here. Yeah. So we have pions, chaos, and etas. So we collect them in some field, in some nonlinear realization like this. It's a matrix value field which has a pi, the pi 0, the pi plus, the pi minus, then the pi 0 and the eta, they can mix, that's why they're in this diagonal, and then there are also the k on the k plus, the k minus, the k 0, and the k 0 bar. These are our 8 Goldstone bosons, these are just 8 fields. So to lowest order, you could write down something like u dagger, but this is 1 just by construction, so that's a constant. The constant is not relevant for the Hamiltonian if you don't do gravity. Therefore, you need certain amount of derivatives, and the lowest order you can have is 2 derivatives, because if you think of parities, if you have 1 derivative, you change the sign, and then you are not parity invariant, but so interactions are parity invariant, so you need 2 derivatives. Therefore, you have this term, d mu u dagger. So this is a so-called generalized kinetic term, and then of course you have an explicit Kyle symmetry breaking term which is proportional to the quark mass matrix. And as we see later, since the quark masses are proportional to pi mass squared, this is also dimension 2 in this Kyle counting. So this Kyle is some external source which you couple into the scalar source, it's just 2 times b times the quark mass, and b is some constants which we later can relate to the quark condensate divided by the pi decay constant, the so-called scalar quark condensate. So that's the whole structure of the theory. To lowest order you have this L2, then you have L4, and then you have L6. So to lowest order there are 2 parameters. There's this f pi, which is the pi decay constant that you can get from the pi on decay. And this is essentially the strength with which a Goldstone boson can couple into a vacuum, because the Goldstone boson has energy of the vacuum, it can couple and constant to other particles, stays directly to the vacuum, and the strength of this coupling is given by the pi decay constant, which you get from the pi decay Litz. In some units is 92 MeV. If you plug in here numbers from the condensate, which you get from QCD subnodes or from the lattice, this is typically 200 MeV cubed. You see that this B is of the order 2 GeV, so it's somewhat larger. And you also see that the Goldstone boson masses are given like this, are derived from the lecture transparency, the pion mass squared is mu plus mb times b, k plus mass squared is ad plus msb, and so on. And this has been worked out in many cases, not only to one loop order, but to two loop order, so which is taken into account all terms up to this here L6. There's a review by Hans Beinens, where all this is discussed in detail. So let me show you how we get to this from the quark to the meson masses. So I want to derive in a very short way these relations here for the pion mass related to the quark light quark mass and the Kalman mass relating to the light quark mass. So we have a symmetry breaking Lagrangian, and our symmetry breaking parameter is the quark masses, so times a function of u. So you can have the leading order f can depend on u, because now you can have u's because you have this extra quark mass. Then there can be d mu u's in higher orders, but since it's an extra derivative, they are of higher orders. So the lowest order is really one quark mass times a function which depends on u. And I just use it in SU2 to make things simpler, and m is just the annual mu and md. So there you can write down two invariants under chiral symmetry, which are m u dagger and u m dagger in the trace. These are two invariants under SU2. And then you can just add them, and you get this symmetry breaking Lagrangian, and this b you pull out, there's of course an overall constant, is real if CP is conserved. And we know that strong reactions are to good approximations, CP conserving, therefore this constant is real, and we don't have to differentiate between these two terms. Now u in SU2 is e to the I tau dot pi, this is the isospin, this is a pi on triplet over f pi. Expands the exponential, the first term is a 1. So you get m times 1 plus 1 times n, dagger and m is real, so it's the same. Then you have a 2x2 matrix, the trace of a 2x2 matrix, which is a unit matrix, is 2, and you see you get mu plus md times f pi squared times b for the first term. Then you also know the trace of a Pauli matrix is 0, so you don't get linear terms in the pi matrix, the next term is quadratic. And you do that, and then you see you get mu plus md times b times alpha and half pi squared from the square term, and then you get higher order terms, so you have more pi on fields. Now let's look at these terms. So this term is clearly related to the vector, because if you differentiate the QCD Lagrangians back to the quark masses, or the limit of vanishing quark masses, you just get minus q by q. So from that, you know, you do vacuum expectation value, you find that u by u is the same as d by d, and this is the same as what is written on the right side here, up to this minus sign, which is plugged over here. It's b f pi square. And because you differentiate this now also with respect to the light quark mass, and you end up with Pf pi square, compare this with this, and then you get this relation. So that relates the so-called scalar quark condensate to this B and the pi decay constant. Of course, then if you go to higher orders, there are corrections. The second term also looks familiar. You see there's 1/2 pi square times a constant, but this is typically Boson mass term. And Boson mass is 1/2 m square field square, and therefore you can directly see that 1/2 pi square m pi square, you read off from here, you see m pi square is m u plus m d b. Now you know that b is expectation of u by u divided by pi square with a minus sign, and then you get this famous Kalman-Husserl relation that m pi square is m u plus m d times the condensate over pi square. This is Kalman-Husserl, this has been derived before QCD using much more complicated methods, and you see how easily you can do that. And if you repeat this whole exercise for SU3, you get this famous Kalman-Husserl relation that 3m eta squared is 4m k squared minus m pi squared. This relation is fulfilled to within a few percent in nature. So here you see how you can relate by this simple manipulations the quark masses, which are the entries in this diagonal matrix, to the meson masses like the pion mass, the Kalman mass, and the eta mass. It doesn't take much of work, and then you can do that more systematically. So lowest order, you find m pi plus is mu plus md times b. This is 0.14 gb squared. The k on the k0 mass is mu plus ms times b. This is 0.494 gb squared. And k plus mass is md plus ms, which is 0.497 gb squared. Now, of course, b you don't know, but you can now get, you cannot, without knowledge of B, you cannot get these absolute values, but you can form ratios, B drops out, and you see that you can get from these quark mass ratios. If you do this, you find mu over MD is 0.66, 2/3, MS over MD is 20, and M hat, which is the average light quark mass, 1/2 MD plus MD over MS is 1 over 24. So the strange quark is considerably heavier than the light quarks. So this one thing, this you already see from here, because the pion only has light quark, it's very light, and here the kaon has one strange quark and it's considerably more heavy. From that you can even read off that the strange quark is considerably more heavy than the up and down quark, but the up and down quarks also are different. Now of course that is leading order, you can go to next leading order and beyond. You have to include electromagnetic correction, because there are also shifts due to the coupling, different charges of the quarks. This has been done by Weinberg, Gass, and Neufeld and other people to pick accuracy. And if you repeat this, you get this more precise number. So mu over md is 0.553. This is uncertainty. Ms over md is 18.9. This is uncertainty. And m hat over ms is 1 over 24 plus minus 1.5. And so now you might of course wonder why there's no large isospin variation, because mu and md are different. That is simply because the absolute values of these are very small. So now if you, for example, from the lattice get some value, one of these values, like strange quark mass to be 90 MeV, then you also get mu and md and you find that there are 2 or 4 MeV, so very small compared to any typical hadronic scale. That's why isospin variation is so small. So this is quite nice, this is very simple. And this is, I find, is quite amazing that you with so simple arguments can go so far. So this is a purely mesonic theory. Now you can put nucleons. And here things are a bit more complicated. So the nucleons are metafields. So of course the nucleons are not constrained by chiral symmetry themselves because they're not related to symmetry vacuum, but the interactions with the pions are of course related, are constrained by the symmetry. And so it lies to SU2. So chiral symmetry dictates the couplings of the nucleons to pions and external sources. So you do the same steps as before, which I'm not going through here. And now, because of the fermionic nature of the nucleons, you find also odd powers in the effective Lagrangian, because that is now consistent with parity, just by constructing invariants from fermion fields, which you know from quantum field theory, like a vector operator, pseudoscalar, and so on. You can do that. And you get this tower of terms, so the leading order is just the kinetic energy with the gauge field in, minus the mass, and then there's this axial coupling where you couple this union, essentially the spin vector, to this, as the relative of the pion field, this gamma bigger, essentially the spin vector, if you do a non-relativistic reduction. And then you see that this term contains like the coupling of the photon to the nucleon, so which is proportional to the charge. It contains also this so-called Weinberg-Tomasawa term, where you have these two pions emerging out of one vertex, which is well known, of course, that the strength is fixed. And this term here gives you the leading order pseudo-vector pion nucleon coupling, because this u contains a derivative of the pion field. And this is just then the coupling of the derivative of the pion field to the spin of the nucleon. This is famous pseudo-vector coupling. But it also contains the famous Kohl-Rudermann term, which makes a charged pion produced by a photon in a vertex, which is very important for charged pion photon production. And again, this is given in terms essentially of this axial vector coupling GA. And then, of course, there are higher order terms with more pions and more external fields. So if you do a three-level calculation, you have to insert all the contribution from these two terms. If you do a one-loop calculation, you have to take tree graphs from all these four terms and loop graphs with one insertion from this lowest order. So that's a bit more complicated, but in fact not so complicated. And here's how the Lagrangian looks. I don't go into the detail, just to show you that it has been worked out. So here are all these Lagrangians are known up to fourth order. This is the leading order one I just showed you. At second order, we have 7 terms. And this is just the structure. So there are some terms which are related to symmetry breaking. So this C1, so this operator is directly proportional to the sum of the light quark masses. And this operator, this gamma, this chi tilde, is related to the difference. So that's isospin breaking mu minus md. So these are related to the quark mass term. So here the mass terms only appear not in leading order, but in next to leading order, which is important. Then you have some what is called dynamical Lorentzian constants, which are related to the derivatives of the pion field, the C2, C3, and the 4. And then there are couplings to external fields. So here you see the photon field string sensor coming in. So these are essentially giving you the isoscalar and isovector anomalous magnetic moment of the proton is the nucleon, so the neutron and proton anomalous magnetic moment. So these terms are absent, so you need an external photon. And then you have higher order terms which you can enumerate and work out. However, there's one problem in this, and we had shown that we had said that important for the EFT is the power counting. Well, you see here the nucleon mass. The nucleon mass is of the order 1 GeV, so this is chiral symmetry breaking scale, so it's not a small energy compared to what we want to deal with, and this in fact makes a problem. So the nucleon mass is 1 GeV, it's not, so only the 3 momentum of the nucleon can be solved, not the 4 momentum, because the 4 momentum contains the mass, and that complicates the power counting. This was shown 1988 by Gasser, Simon, and Swartz. So in the purely mesonic sector you have these simple, very clear a one-to-one correspondence between the loop expansion and the expansion in powers of momenta. So three levels, I just derived this yesterday, have dimension 2. So the three-level amplitude, which my zero loops, is dimension 2, so Q square. The one-loop amplitude has dimension 4, two-loop amplitude dimension 6, and so on. So you have this very simple linear relation, and that makes life very easy. Now if you take this, the pi nuclear series and leave the nuclear mass in there like it is, you get this unfortunately completely filled diagram, which makes life very hard. So you don't have any clear ordering anymore, because you get a mix of small and large momenta because the nuclear mass, which is 1 GeV, is in there. So you have to in some way to remove the nuclear mass. And there are two ways which I will discuss. One is this so-called Hebel-Baron approach, which was pioneered by Jenkins Manoa and our group in the early 90s. So that is very easy to understand. If you ever have done quantum mechanics 2 with the Dirac equation with a heavy field, you know how this goes. So you consider the nucleon as a steady Hebbian source and you introduce a 4 velocity. So you write the nucleon momentum as the nucleon mass times its 4 velocity, and of course p square has to be m square, so v square is 1. P square is an m square, and then there's a small so-called off-shadow residual momentum L, but V dot L is much less than m nucleon. So this is a general form of the four momentum you can write down. And then you do a velocity projection. So you write your spinner in terms of a large and small components with this exponential factor, which looks familiar in the rest frame, because then you just get E dot T. And this V essentially are velocity eigenstates, so there's the plus velocity plus 1, so the capital H is velocity eigenvalue plus 1, and the small h is velocity eigenvalue minus 1. Because v square is 1, so it can be plus or minus 1. And now you can easily, you plug this in and you see that to leading order these components decouple, and they are separated by the large mass gap 2mn. And this of course removes then essentially the antinucleons from the theory. So from this relativistic theory, which of course is nuclear and antinucleons, you go to this static non-relativistic theory, and then of course essentially what you see, you get the lowest order, so this becomes V dot D, this gamma mu turns into a velocity times the covariant derivative, and then here, what I told you before, you get GA times the spin times this derivative of the pi m theory, which is this U, and you see no more mass term, all the mass has been moved into 1 over a mass suppressed vertex correction. That's like when you do Fourier Boutazel transformation in standard Dirac theory. And this is very simple because you can now express all, essentially all operators in terms of this velocity, the so-called covariant spin vector order Pauli-Lubansky. So this is S mu, which is this covariant form, gamma 5 sigma mu v mu. S dot v is 0 just by the anti-symmetric property of this operator. The anti-commutator of two of these spin matches is this, and S squared itself in D dimension is 1 minus D over 4, so in 4 dimension is minus 3 quarter. And the Dirac algebra then considerably simplifies, because you only need this V mu, this 4 velocity, and the spin vector. So for example, H by gamma mu H is, as I told you, V mu H by H. H by gamma 5 H goes like, is 1 of M suppressed, because now you have no more coupling with large and small components. And H bar gamma mu gamma 5 is just twice the spin vector, and so on and so forth. So you can express all these complicated 4x4 matrices in this very simple V and S matrices. And the propagator just writes like I over omega plus I eta omega is V dot L, and it goes to 0 plus. So the mass scale is removed from the propagator to the string of 1 over suppressed vertices, and that allows for power counting, and that you can extend to arbitrary orders 1 over n, as we have shown. And then there's this second way you can deal with this problem, which was essentially given by Becher and Dornfield and has been then modified by other people later. So this is a different approach, and I'll discuss them both in a moment. So if you calculate this as these people did, the relativistic nucleon self-energy, so this nucleon has a pion loop, so you get in D dimension, you get this integral over the phase space, and then you have the pion propagator m squared minus k squared, this is this one, and then you have the nucleon propagator m, there's a square missing, sorry, m square minus p square, and there's of course something in the denominator which is already taken out. And you can see that if you work out this in the dimensions, you get this form, there's a constant which depends on dimensionality of space, and then you get the terms which go like m pi to the d minus 3, and m n t- d minus 3 divided by the sum of nuclear plus biomass. And this red stuff is called the infrared singular piece. This is generated by moment of the order of m pi. So that it contains all the chiral physics we are interested in, the small scale physics. Then this black stuff here is called R. So this here is called the infrared regular piece. This is generated by moment of the order mn. And these are the terms which lead to the violation of the power counting, which I showed you before. But this is a polynomial in the quark masses, so the pile mass and the external momenta, because there is no explicit appearance here. So it has to be a polynomial in the pile mass of the quark mass. And therefore, you can absorb these in the low energy constant of the effective Lagrangian. So in fact, you can drop this by absorbing this contribution in low energy constant. And then you only keep this so-called infrared singular piece, which is generated by the small moment and the loop. Now this appears arbitrary, but in fact there's a prescription to do that for any one loop integral. You can extend it also to higher loops, which is more difficult, but you can do it. Because you can, this splitting is symmetry preserving, you can show that all the constraints of chiral symmetry are fulfilled by this splitting. It's a bit of work, but you can do that. And you can do the splitting in a very simple way for any one loop graph. So this is canonical form of a one loop graph with two propagators. Then you use a Feynman trick, you combine them in this way. And you see you integrate here over this Feynman parameter from 0 to 1. This is the standard Feynman trick. Now what you do, 0 to 1, you can write as 0 to infinity minus 1 to infinity. You split this. And then you can analytically show that this first integral gives you the infrared singular piece. And the second part gives you, for any one loop diagram, the infrared regular piece. That means this is easy to calculate, so you can really, for any loop diagram, you can very simply get this piece you're interested in. And this preserves the analytic structure of any one loop graph. As I said, you can also do that at higher loops. It's more difficult, but you can do that. So these are the two schemes which you can do. So one operates on the Lagrangian by removing the mass term in 1 over n suppressed vertex corrections. And this directly works still with a relativistic theory, but then kind of operates on the loop integrals themselves. Now, here's a comparison. So heavy baryon is algebraically much simpler because you work with these non-relativistic fields. You just have these V velocities and the spin vector, which is much simpler than all these gamma mu's and gamma phi's. And this heavy baryon can be easier extended to higher loop orders. This infrared is more difficult. It can be done, but it's more difficult. However, the problem is that the strict heavy baryon approach is sometimes at odds with the analytic structure, which never happens here because this always keeps the analytic structure correct. So for example, in a triangle diagram like this, so here's your nucleon line, and here you have pions, and they're coupled to some external source, for example, an isovector photon, or some scalar source. So this triangle diagram you can show as so-called anomalous threshold. So the threshold is that there's a cut in the complex plane at 4 mpi squared minus mpi to the 4th of a nucleon square, which is very close, so that Tc is then at 3.98 mpi squared. So this is on the second Riemann sheet, but it's, this singularity is very close to the physical threshold, therefore you get an inference. Now if you go to the strict heavy baryon limit, of course this drops, because it goes like 1 mn squared, so then the singularity coalesces with the threshold. And that of course can generate some problems. However, this is easy to deal with. In principle, you can take a slightly modified heavy baryon propagator, and this also works. So this is in some diagrams, this can be a problem, but one knows how to deal with this. Sometimes infrared has the advantage, because you take the full relativistic propagator, you resum all the 1 over m corrections in the propagator, that then sometimes can lead to improved conversions. For example, if you calculate the Newton electric form factor, which is a small quantity, therefore sensitive to small corrections. If you do heavy baryon to third order, you get this result. If you do fourth order, you get that result. So this lower blue curve is the upper red curve. If you do infrared calculation, third order, you get this, and fourth order, you get that. So you see that the difference between the two orders is much less, and this converges faster. And this is because the resummation of the kinetic energy terms for that particular observable are kind of important. There are not many where this is important, but this is one. So sometimes to work harder using this relativistic theory pays, but often it does not pay. For example, in threshold fine photo production, such effects are absolute. You can just do it with heavy barium, you get very good results there. And if you do it in relativistic, you just work hard and get the same results. And here's what I'm still lacking is the power counting. Now, yesterday I did the power counting for the purely bosonic theory. Now I have to repeat this argument including nucleons. So let's do it for simplicity in the heavy barium scheme. So mass is eliminated. So we have a propagator which goes like 1 over v dot q. So q is our small momentum. And we have vertices we have seen with d larger or equal than 1. Eh? The lowest order was dimension 1, and then dimension 2, and so on. The Goldstone bosons are as before. Here d is larger or equal 2, as discussed, and the propagator goes like 1 over q square minus m squared. And m is irrelevant here, the pi and mass for the discussion. So now we consider an L-loop diagram is I, B internal barium lines, I, M internal meson lines, VDM mesonic vertices, and VDM being mesonuclear vertices of order D. So what do we get? The amplitude is given by an integral over D4Q. It's L-loop, so to the Lth power. We have IM internal meson lines, so we have 1 over Q squared to the IM, because this mass is irrelevant for this argument. Then we have 1 over q to the IB, the internal barium lines, because the propagator goes like 1 over q. And then we have to multiply all the vertices, q to the d. We have VDM mesonic vertices plus VDMB mesonuclear vertices of dimension d, so q to the d times the number of such vertices. So if you say the amplitude goes like q to the nu is our chiral dimension, we can read this off, it's 4L minus 2IM, because it's downstairs, minus IB, it's downstairs, and then plus the sum, so this, of course, this multiplication turns into sum, d times this bracket here. Now, by topology, you can show that the number of loops is related to the number of internal meson and barium lines plus the number of, minus the number of vertices plus 1. Just draw some arbitrary diagrams, arbitrary many loops, you can see that this is true. And now there's one important restriction to this. Now we have to assume that there's one barium line running through the diagram. So this does not hold anymore if you have two or three barium lines in the diagram. So we just look at but the process is where you have one nucleon in the instead and one nucleon in the outstage. So one nucleon line runs through the diagram. So it's a pionucleon sector. Then, in that case, we can further find that the sum of all meson barium vertices is the sum of the internal barium lines plus one, because this is just counting. And then we can eliminate this IM, and we get this. This is a formula we have seen yesterday. The only difference here. So we had this yesterday, this is a mesonic vertices system d minus 2. Now we have this additional mesonuclear vertices with d minus 1. And this one, this was 2 before, there's now 1 because there's a lowest order coupling which was like dimension 1. So you see, again, loops are suppressed by two powers of momentum because 2L, so L is 1, then you get an extra 2, L is 2, you get a 4, and so on. And you see that nu is now larger or equal than 1. In the purely meson sectors was larger or equal to 2. Because you have simple 1 over n pi in 1 terms as a Lorentz function. But this again shows you how to organize a theory, and now you can easily do that. And here's the structure of the pionuclear interaction. In current perturbation, the leading order, neutral 1. Let's call that. So the lowest order vertices in the meson barium sector have dimension 1, so this is d minus 1 is 0. The lowest order meson vertices or pi and pi vertices have d equal 2, so this is 0. No loops, L equals 0, so the lowest order you can have is neutral 1. Okay, this is our lowest order. So you can have a pion being absorbed by the nucleon, and then the nucleon propagates, and then the pion gets emitted. So this vertex goes like q, it's our pseudo vector pi nucleon coupling. So two q's, and this propagator of something is 1 over q. So 1 over q times q times q is q. And you also have this Weinberg-Tomasawa term from the lowest order, which was dimension 1. So that is of the same order than this, plus other terms with external fields, if you have external fields. Next to leading order, if you do the counting, is nu equal 2. I mean, you can do that in your head. We have two terms with insertion of d equal 1 and 2. So you get this Weinberg-Tomasawa-like term. Instead of a lowest order, you have a next to leading order insertion, which goes like two dimension, one of the CIs in this Lagrangian. Or you have a dimension two insertion here on this vertex, and you propagate and so on. So you have one of these dimensions two, which gives you one order higher, because essentially you have one of these, which means you get an additional one from here. So as one of such vertices is equal to two, you get an extra one. And you can follow this up. So now at next to next leading order new equal three, you can play the same game with two cubed insertions here. And of course you get the first loop, because now you can have lowest order vertices with q, ion propagator, you have to integrate over d4 q, and you see that's just q to the power 3 or d equal 3. And in fact, calculations have been performed up to next to next to next to leading order, so complete for neutral 4. So I've done this with a student at Diafettis zillions of years ago. Then Becher and Wolfiller did the calculation in the infinite realization scheme 1 year later, and then in this, this is a variant of the scheme which is somewhat easier to handle. I don't discuss this here in detail. There are a group in China and a group in Spain have redone the calculation. Results are always very similar. And of course there are no unknown coefficients. I mean, of course there are these coefficients which come with dimension two operators which appear, and there are four of them if you work at the Einstein symmetric case. And then there are a certain number of dimension 3 and dimension 4 couplings. In total, just by analyticity and unitarity of the scattering amplitude, you can have 14 order Q4, but there are of course huge amount of data to which you fit, and this can be done. Now here I want to discuss that this seems like parameter fitting, but once you have fitted the parameter, say in the pi nuclear system, there appear many other processes, and that's where the strength of the method shows itself. So the point is that these low energy constants relate many processes. For example, these CI legs, this C1, C2, C3, C4, so they're related to the sigma term and the pi nucleon scattering. These appear in pi n, so here, for example, I can fit them by fitting my amplitude to the experimental data, but then it also appears in the nucleon-nucleon potential in this kind of triangle graph, and now the strength is fixed, or it also appears in the leading order 3-nucleon potential, where pi n runs to the left and to the right of this nucleon line to two other lines. So that shows that once I fix these lowest order unknown couplings in pi nucleon scattering, I immediately get these contributions in two nuclear nucleon forces also fixed. And that of course is the strength of the method. And so what we have been doing, other people do other things, I show at the moment you determine the CI from the purest process, which is pi nucleon scattering, and then you use them in the calculation of the nuclear forces. Other people do that the other way around, but I think that's not so. And here's essentially what you do. You can do that in two ways. So this is a Mandelstam plane, a new T plane. So you have here the S channel, the T channel far away because it's 4n squared, the U channel. And then there is this blue triangle in which, and of course, the pi nucleon amplitude is complex. But inside this triangle, the amplitude is real. So what you can do, you can either work in the physical region close to the threshold, which is here, and then just fit to the data, or you can take some dispersion representation like the Karlsruhe-Helsinki, and which gives you also the amplitude inside this triangle, because here the Karl experiment should really converge best, and then you just compare to this dispersive representation and fit the parameters like that. This has been done. So the fit pi is getting inside the Mandelstam triangle, best conversion, because here the momenta are really the smallest, because here you always have the threshold momentum. And of course that relies that you have a good dispersive analysis available, which however Karlsruhe-Helsinki provides. And this has been done again in 2000, and you can fit most of the constant, but not C2, it's not very sensitive to C2, which you understand because C2 has two derivatives in a particular way which are not very sensitive when you have small momentum. But if you fit in the threshold region, which means here, to the physical data, you have a large database, however not all these data are consistent, then you can use threshold parameters and make global fits, and this has been done by various groups, and you get this set of parameters which are consistent with the ones inside. And I just show you for completeness how these look in units. So the natural units are inverse GeV. So the natural expected size of such a constant, so Ci by dimension analysis, which I explained yesterday, is Ga over lambda chi. This is roughly 1.3 divided by 1.2 GeV, so it's of the order 1 inverse GeV. So that's what you expect for these constants. and that's what comes out. So C1 is 0.1, 0.9, this is uncertain, these are not symmetric necessarily. C2, C3, and C4 are somewhat larger than what you naturally expect from this estimate. And this you can understand because they absorb the contribution from the delta. So you know that if pi nuclear is getting the delta resonance, the delta 1232 plays an important role. And this is close to the nuclear mass. And delta minus in nuclear is only 300 MeV. And therefore such diagrams are pretty important. And if you now shrink this to a point, as explained yesterday, so you let the delta become infinitely heavy, then you shrink this to a point. So M delta goes to infinity. Then essentially you get an operator like this. But then you see this goes like some constant over M delta minus M nucleon, and this is only 0.3 GeV, you can get a large enhancement by a factor of 3. Just from considering this not explicitly but as a contact term.
Don't you also get a problem because the width of the delta is so large? I mean, it's hard to think of it as a particle. It's
no, so this can be worked out, and the width of the delta is roughly 100 MeV. The delta can be incorporated in principle, then you can do the calculation, and which comes at higher orders for this estimate doesn't play a role. But this has been done, there have been an explicit version where the delta is included as explicit degree, but this doesn't affect these couplings here. This goes to higher coupling because the width comes later. Because you need a loop to open the width. So that these are larger than one can be nicely understood just from this delta effect. This has been worked out in 97 by Bernard Kaiser and myself. And the uncertainty here is fairly large because there's still debate about how big the sigma term is, which is not yet settled. And then other people have tried to get these from peripheral nuclear-nucleon waves because they are sensitive to pion exchanges, and you get these numbers which are also consistent with what we get, only that you have to input this value from the sigma term. You don't get C2 as before from the dispersal analysis. So that's another way you can do that, but whether it's really that precise, this has been challenged by other people who do NN scattering. So, but at least it's consistent, and that's of course what you know, because in the peripheral nuclear-nuclear waves, you have one pion exchange is completely fixed, and then you get some small contribution of two pion exchange, then it should be sensitive to essentially these constants here. This was the same idea like people who constructed the Paris or Stoney-Brook potential in nuclear-nuclear scattering. And the last issue I want to address in this hour, which takes a bit longer, is the bound state effective field theory, because as we will see, the nicest way to get at these scattering lengths, which are zero energy scattering, which are very sensitive to symmetry breaking, are these so-called hadronic atoms. So I briefly developed a theory of hadronic atoms and then take a short break and then I show the applications. So hadronic atoms are bound states of two hadrons which are bound by the Coulomb, static Coulomb force. So like a pi plus or pi minus, or maybe most known as a pionic hydrogen. So instead of an electron surrounding a proton, you have a pi minus surrounding a proton. And of course the radius of this system is large, and therefore the strong reaction only have determinative character. So the Bohr radius of such a system is much bigger than the typical scale of strong reactions. And the average momenta in this system are very small, so it's entirely non-relativistic. And I'll give you precise numbers later. Now, so what happens here is your standard QED calculation is 1 is 0, 3 p states, and so on. Now, if you add these pions, for example, in the proton, the higher levels are essentially unaffected. In the lower levels, there are two effects. There's a shift, which goes either up and down, whether the injection is repulsive or attractive. And then there's a broadening, so there's a width generated. And this you can measure. So this shift in width you can measure. And that, therefore, gives you essentially zero energy scattering between the pion and the proton. And these scattering lengths are sensitive to chiral symmetry and isospin symmetry breaking, as I will show. And now we have to analyze such systems, we have to set up effective field theory for such bound states, because of course these are bound states which are not incorporated in the theory discussed so far, because we just discussed scattering states. Now the effective field theory of hadronic atoms is a so-called nested effective field theory, which in a way is made up in three-step procedure. So first you construct a non-relativistic effective theory, which can have complex couplings, and you solve the Coulomb problem exactly in correction from storm direction, you generate a perturbation theory. So that is, this is similar. Now, of course, these couplings we have to relate to the couplings to the underlying parameters of QCD, like the scattering length. So that's called matching. So here you have just some numbers which are complex. Of course, they're open channels. These things can decay. And now you have, in the second step, you do what is called matching. You relate these couplings to the fundamental parameters of QCD, like the scattering lengths. And then you can express the energy shift is complex, so there's an energy shift in the bits in terms of these QCD parameters. And then, once you have measured this, you can now extract the scattering lengths from the measured complex energy shift. And this is presumably the most precise of determining hadron-hadron scattering lengths. And I will show you this in an example of kyanic hydrogen, because I was involved in the theory of this one. And there's a very nice review article by Gasser, Lubitsky, and Rosetsky, which appeared like a few years ago in Physics Report. All the details. For kyanic hydrogen is a bound state of a K minus and a proton. And of course, this is very complex because there are many strong decay channels. So K minus proton can decay in pi naught lambda and sigma plus, pi plus sigma minus, pi minus sigma plus, as shown here. And all these thresholds are split by either spin breaking, of course, further. And then there are also weaker electromagnetic decay. So that's very complicated, interesting analytical structure. So now, that I said that the system is highly non-relativistic. The average momentum in such a system is alpha times mu. Mu is a reduced mass of pi and kaon. And alpha is a fine structure constant, 1 over 137. If you calculate the reduced mass of kaon in a proton, it's roughly 270. So this is 270 divided by 137 is 2. It's 2 MeV. So it's really small. It's a non-relativistic system. So it's highly non-relativistic. The Bohr radius is 1 over alpha mu. So you plug this in, alpha mu is 1 over 2 MeV, so it's 100 Fermi. So it's huge compared to typically the strong action scale of 1 Fermi. The binding energy, therefore, you can calculate in the 1s state is 1 half alpha square mu, it's roughly 8 keV. And the bits is 250 eV, it's much smaller than this binding energy. And one important thing in this system is the unitary cusp, because you see, you have the K minus proton threshold, and then there's very close to K0 by N, and they are only separated by a few MeV, and that will play a role later on. So that is, this closeness of these two different thresholds will play the role. And of course, you have to include isospin breaking, and the parameter you count here is the fine structure constant and the quark mark difference. So then in leading order, the energy is given, if you do this counting, if you take all the prefactors into account, delta cubed, and then next leading was delta 4 and so on. So you expand in fine structure constant the quark mass differences. And this is how the effective Lagrangian looks at lowest order. So there are photon fields, so there are f mu. Then you have a part, you see, for the protons, this is just the kinetic energy of the protons, power expanded in 1 over m proton. And these are, of course, covariant relatives. And then you have coupling to also to E and B fields, which give you, for example, the magnetic moments. You have a similar line for the neutron. Of course, the neutron has only kinetic energy here. You have fields for the kaons. Again, there's kinetic energy, and then you have coupling to some electric field, neutral kaons, charged kaons. And then these are the couplings of the kaons to the protons and the neutrons. Of course, these coupling constants are complex valued at this level. So it's completely general, and from that you can calculate electromagnetic levels and the strong shift. The strong shift, of course, embodied in this coupling constant here. Now this shift looks like this. It has many contributions, but it's not difficult. You have recoil corrections, so on. You have like corrections on the proton and the kaon line. There's transverse photon exchange, so from the transverse part of the photons. You have finite size corrections, so the nucleon has a finite size, electric and magnetic. The kaon has a finite electromagnetic size. This gives you correction. And of course, you can have vacuum polarization, so that's that you have here like a plus and minus pair generated by this exchange photon. And then, of course, there's this leading K minus proton action, which is one of these constants. You can iterate this. You can include photons here. So it all becomes a bit complicated. And you also can have this intermediate K0 by N state, which is gives me to discuss. So, I mean, all these things you can calculate fairly easily. And the next thing you have to do, you have to match now to fix this constant and these constants in terms of scatteringness and other parameters. And this is easy. First, the electromagnetic form factors tell you, so you look at these three-point functions, you see that these constants Cp and Cf are just given by the magnetic moment of the proton and charge radius squared in certain combinations, and the one for the kaon is just given by the kaon mass times the charge radius of the kaon. And then you can express the energy shift, which is the real part plus the mix, in terms of the kaon nucleon scattering amplitude, and this is a general formula which is due to Deza, Goldberger, and others from the 50s. And you see that you see alpha cubed, mu is the reduced mass of the system, cubed, and then you get some kinematical factors here, times the scattering amplitude, and then you get corrections due to the Coulomb exchange, which this factors in the vacuum polarization. And you see to leading order at this low energies, you can write the scattering amplitude as a prefactor times the two scattering lengths. So there's an isoscalar and also vector kinematical scattering length. So that's essentially here how you see that you connect this shift to these complex valued scattering lengths. Now this formula is correct, however if you work it out, it's not sufficiently accurate, because there's one effect which was already pointed out by Dalitz and in Tuan in the late 50s, early 60s, and you can do the systematic in ZFT. Because of this close by second threshold from K0 by N, you have to resum this whole bubble series, and then instead of having just the sum of the threshold, the sum of the scattering lengths, you get this geometric series where you have this factor, which is essentially this mass difference of the two thresholds times the reduced mass in the K0 neutron system. And you see this is the, if Q0 goes to zero, you recover the old formula. But this is just a geometric series of this. And this is highly accurate, as you will see. So then there are further corrections from current perturbation, which you can work out. They're expected to be small. And this has been first done by Dalitz and Tuan using some less rigorous methods. So we, of course, we cover the results. And then you get the finite formula for the shift in the kaon equation. I will use this later. The real part, imaginary part, so the prefactor is the same. Then you get here these lowest order amplitude and these corrections, which are subsumed in this form here. And then there are further corrections due to other KPT effects which you can estimate, but these are small, so 2% effect. And the vacuum polarization also known. This is formally of higher order, but this has been calculated, this is a 1% effect. So this formula is precise enough to extract from the measured width, shift in width of kaonic hydrogen the combination of threshold parameters which are embedded here in this TKN0. I show you later how that works. So now this is for this part. I'm soon finished with this first lecture. So for the strong reactions, so here's QCD. There are many of EFTs. So I discussed so far essentially this current perturbation, which is effective fields of the up-down and strange quarks, also coupled to nucleons. However, you can also, for heavy quarks like the charms, the bottom, you can derive a similar effective theory, which is based on the fact that the quark, the masses are here and here, the masses are very light, so to leading order they are absent here, the masses are very heavy, so to leading order this is a very heavy system, this heavy quark effective field theory. You can do nuclear physics by doing Carrier EFT, combining this with some resummation, because of course you have to generate bound states like nucleons, so that's a bit more complicated. I gave you a glimpse of this in the talk on Friday, not discussing this here any further. Then you can do contact EFTs where you just have contact interaction, which allows you to study universality, because then the properties do not depend on the precise homodynamics anymore, but just on the scattering lengths, which can become very large, and then you get universal properties, which you can address, and also that can, for example, be applied to nuclear physics. Then there's lattice nuclear EFT, which combines this with lattice methods, also given in this talk on Friday, and Dean can tell you all the details you want to know, or Thomas. And of course, you can also, if you do lattice QCD, which means you simulate whole QCD in a finite space-time box, you have to account for these effects from the finite box and the finite lattice space, and all these effects can be analyzed in terms of properly tailored EFTs. So for this lecture, let me just summarize and then we have a short break. But as I always say, my lectures, life is too short to make breaks, so there's a long break once you are dead, so let's keep the break short. So QCD has a kind symmetry in the Lightwork sector. So if you neglect the light quark masses, the symmetry is exact, otherwise it's what's called an approximate symmetry, because as the quark masses are so much smaller than all the other scales, you can treat it as an approximate symmetry. So the chiral symmetry is spontaneously broken and explicitly broken. So spontaneous breaking is that the SU3 left plus SU3 right breaks down to the vectorial subgroup with the appearance of eight almost massless Goldstone bosons, the three pions of okaons in the ether. And the Goldstone boson interactions have to vanish as energy and momenta go to zero. This, I showed you this, therefore you have the relative couplings. And these are almost Goldstone bosons because of the small explicit breaking. And I've shown you that the just from the pion and kaon mass, you can read off that the U and D masses are very small versus strange quark masses, factor of 20 or 25 bigger. So chiral perturbations use the effective field theory of QCD that explores this chiral symmetry in the spontaneous and explicit breaking, and in fact also the so-called anomalous breaking, which is another thing which I didn't discuss here. If you write this down in the meson sector, so your basic fields are then these Goldstone bosons, so the light fields. You have only even powers and small momenta because of parity, essentially, and Lorentz invariants. And this has been successfully tested in many applications. I have no time to discuss this. Single nucleon sector, because of the structure of the spin 1/2 field, you have odd and even powers, and there are also quite a few successes. There are also some cases where it doesn't work so well. Now, in all this, you have, of course, these low energy constants, which parameterize the higher order terms, and you have to fit them to data. Once you have done that, I've shown you that these low energy constants relate many processes. I picked this example of this dimension 2 pi nucleon coupling CI, which related pi nucleon scattering to the 2 nucleon and the 3 nucleon forces, which is particularly nice. And you can also, if you want to incorporate isospin breaking, so the light quark mass difference MD minus mu and the photon effects, because if you, once you do that, you have to include also effects from virtual photons. This can be systematically done. If somebody asks, I can do this in the spares, but this is technically just a bit more work. And then I showed you that you can set up a non-relativistic effective field theory for hadronic atoms, so bound states of two hadrons, which are very large systems, so that essentially they are bound by the Coulomb force, and the strong interactions, because the systems are so large, are very small perturbations, and you can then make very precise calculation of the effect of the strong interactions on this exactly calculable electromagnetic spectrum. And that will allow, because essentially that is scattering at zero energy, this will allow to extract the scattering lengths to high precision. And in the next lecture, we'll essentially discuss various systems like pi tri, pi k, pi n, what you can do there, and how far we are in extracting the scattering lengths, and what we have learned about the QCD chiral dynamics from that. Okay, thanks for the moment. Questions?
So, regarding on this small pion mass and the large nucleon mass separation, I think at least I have some example that, like in the non-analytic behavior of pion mass infrared, like you have a loop calculation, n pi cube, and then you have something like n pi square log n pi, and then, you know, for the dimensionality, actually, you have a nuclear mass multiplied with n pi square log n pi, so that it doesn't really separate between the large m and the small n pi. In some cases, I mean, there is a...
No, the nuclear mass. So the leading singularity goes like, so the nuclear mass is a function of pion mass, goes like this. There's a term which is a mass in the chiral limit, which is non-vanishing. Then there's C1 and pi square, which is this famous sigma term. Then you have GA square and pi cubed over 32 pi f pi square, which is this in pi cubed term we talk about. And then you have, and this is the only thing, and then you get m pi 4 log m pi 4 over some scale mu times the coefficient which you can calculate. So there's not m pi square log m pi square.
Well, I mean, if you just stick with this chiral perturbation theory, you don't get it. But I'm saying mathematically you actually do like a pseudo-scalar coupling. That's what, for example, like a Jerry Miller.
Yeah, but that's wrong.
But I mean, the point is that mathematically you cannot really say that this is always separate.
No, you can, because if you take chiral symmetry series, you have pseudo-vector coupling. And pseudo-vector, pseudo-scalar coupling are equivalent on tree level, but not on loop level anymore.
Yeah, so
you, if you do loop calculation, you have to do, if you want to do trick, you have to do pseudo-vector coupling.
So that's kind of, in some sense, it's a little bit beyond mathematics. It's a, if you just stick with some naive pseudo-scalar theory.
No, it's not beyond mathematics, because the point is that if you believe in chiral symmetry breaking, which one should do, then the interaction of the Goldstone boson to the matter field has to be of derivative nature. This is a consequence of the Goldstone theorem.
So you're saying that if you don't see this separation, then you can actually tell the theory is a sick or not?
I don't know whether that gets the logic of your... the argument is the following. So chiral symmetry is broken, and then you have these Goldstone bosons. The Goldstone bosons must couple by derivatively to any other field, to themselves and to matter.
That's what we, have in this chiral perturbation theory. But
this is general principle of chiral symmetry breaking. If you have a Goldstone boson, the Goldstone boson has to couple derivatively.
Yeah, but I mean, if you actually just use some naive, phenomenological model, you can actually have this.
I think what he's saying is if you have just a black box that has a pion like object in it, and if it has a parameter that you can scale to zero, that has chiral symmetry, right, and it's at the zero limit, then if that parameter is small, you can't have a large vector like coupling that will generate these large parameters.
Well, if it is a vector like coupling, then you do. But I mean, if you have some other.
If it does have a large vector like coupling, then it's not close to the chiral symmetry limit.
Yeah, so that's what I'm saying. So that if you don't see this thing, then you can tell actually the theory actually satisfies or not.
So if you have this spontaneous breaking, then these coefficients are given, and there can be no term like you said, like m pi squared times equilibrium.
Yeah, there is. I'm just telling that there is some things that you can experience that in the calculation.
Yeah, but of course, in principle, I mean, if you work, no, let's not go into this. So, I mean, it's just, life is so much simpler if you work with all the time with pseudo vector, just forget pseudo scalar. This has been done in the ages, and one shouldn't do that anymore. That's it, like, yes, for the students, don't do that anymore.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, you can fix it order by order, but yeah, it's going to be tedious.
Yeah, but yeah, I'm not even sure that, yeah, you probably fix it all over, but I mean, why should you do that if you can do it much easier?
Because you can always imagine that, say, it descended from a linear sigma model and just decalculate.
Yeah, but this is the worst way to do it, because then you have to kind of, all the constraints you get for free if you work with pseudo vector coupling, you then have to impose by proper cancellations, and that you don't really want to do.
Yeah, showing the equivalence in perturbation theory is, of course, very, very tricky.
Yeah, but so, I mean, why doing that if you can do it so much simpler like this?
Mm-hmm. It depends on the authors, though.
All right, so shall we then take a 5-minute break?
5-minute break,
okay.